A very warm welcome to Keele University's carol service. The prophet Isaiah wrote these words: "The people walking in darkness have seen a great light. On those living in the land of deep darkness, a light has dawned. For to us a child is born, to us a son is given. And the government shall be on his shoulders, and he will be called Wonderful Counselor, Mighty God, Everlasting Father, Prince of Peace. Of the greatness of his government and peace, there will be no end." So it is that we meet in the presence of the living God, in the light of God's love, to hear afresh the wonder of the Christmas story, to ponder the mystery of the Word made flesh, and to share in the joy and hope that this season brings.
A reading from the Gospel of Matthew, chapter 1. This is how the birth of Jesus, the Messiah, came about. His mother Mary was pledged to be married to Joseph. But before they came together, she was found to be pregnant through the Holy Spirit. Because Joseph, her husband, was faithful to the law and yet did not want to expose her to public disgrace, he had in mind to divorce her quietly. But after he had considered this, an angel of the Lord appeared to him in a dream and said, "Joseph, son of David, do not be afraid to take Mary as your wife, because what is conceived in her is from the Holy Spirit. She will give birth to a son, and you are to give him the name Jesus, because he will save his people from their sins." All this took place to fulfill what the Lord had said through the prophet: "The virgin will conceive and give birth to a son, and they will call him Emmanuel," which means God with us. When Joseph woke up, he did what the angel of the Lord had commanded him and took Mary home to be his wife. But he did not consummate their marriage until she gave birth to a son, and he gave him the name Jesus. This is the word of the Lord. Thanks be to God.
Reading from the Gospel of Luke, chapter 2. There were shepherds living out in the fields nearby, keeping watch over their flocks at night. An angel of the Lord appeared to them, and the glory of the Lord shone around them, and they were terrified. But the angel said to them, "Do not be afraid. I bring you good news that will cause great joy for all the people. Today, in the town of David, a Saviour has been born to you. He is the Messiah, the Lord. This will be a sign to you. You will find a baby wrapped in cloths and lying in a manger." Suddenly, a great company of the heavenly host appeared with the angel, praising God and saying, "Glory to God in the highest heaven, and on earth peace to those on whom his favor rests." When the angels had left them and gone into heaven, the shepherds said to one another, "Let's go to Bethlehem and see this thing that has happened, which the Lord has told us about." So they hurried off and found Mary and Joseph and the baby who was lying in the manger. When they had seen him, they spread the word concerning what had been told to them about this child, and all who heard it were amazed at what the shepherds said to them. But Mary treasured up all these things and pondered them in her heart. The shepherds returned, glorifying and praising God for all the things they had heard and seen, which were just as they had been told. This is the word of the Lord.
Bethlehem, a Christmas poem by Carol Ann Duffy. A mild dusk, the little town snaked on the edge between desert and farmland. Camel prints in the sand like broken hearts, the call and response of sheep among dry shrubs. To the west, the whispering prayers of olive groves, incense of rosemary, cedar, pine, votive on purpling air. Everyone there who had to be there. The lamps lit, all Bethlehem full. Every cave stabled with beasts, jostling for hay in the fusty gloom. Every room peopled and packed from rafter to floor. Barley bread in the ovens rising. And a girl's hand at an open door, her blade halving a pomegranate, its blood on her pale palms. A voice from an alleyway chanting a psalm. The mood rose, shepherds sprawled, shawled a rough ring on sparse grass, passing a leather flask. From the town, a swelling human sound, cooking smells braided the hour as lambs and fish spat in the fires. 100 suppers, honey, fig, olive, grape, set before stonecutter, potter, tent maker, maid, nurse, farmer, child. Young wine in the old jars, yellow and cold. The inn bulged, travelers boozed, bawled, bragging, swapping their caravan tales, money lenders biting their gold coins. Painted women dancing on tables, mules brayed. Outside in the stable, a youth in the courtyard strummed on a harp. The sweating innkeeper shouted and served, his wife counting the heads, then making up beds on the flat roof in the vine-covered yard. Above, bright news in the sky, arrived a star. The small hours, all living souls slept, or half slept. The night fires smouldering low out in the scrub, the olive oil cooling in clay lamps. A goat herd snored in the straw between two goats. Silent night. A soft breeze from the desert, laying a dusting of sand on the dark road, blessing the homes. A donkey's slow, deliberate hooves on the stones. Afterwards, the witnesses spoke of a singing boy, an angel walking in the fields in the hours before dawn, winged in his own light, of how shepherds fled from the sight, lambs in their arms. And some swore on their lives, on their children's lives, they saw an olive tree turned to pure gold, that the moon swooped low to gape at the world. What's certain? The time and the place. Heard, three crows from the cockerel. Seen, the stable behind the inn. Present, animals, goat herd, shepherd, innkeeper, wife. Then the small, raw cry of a new life. And one wept at a miracle. Another was hoping it might be so. Others ran, daft, shouting to boast in the waking streets. Wise men swayed on camels out of the east.
Angels strong when you kiss your lips. A reading from the Gospel of Matthew, chapter 2. After Jesus was born in Bethlehem in Judea, during the time of King Herod, Magi from the east came to Jerusalem and asked, "Where is the one who has been born, King of the Jews? We saw his star when it rose and have come to worship him." When King Herod heard this, he was disturbed, and all of Jerusalem with him. When he had called together all the people's chief priests and teachers of the law, he asked them where the Messiah was to be born. "In Bethlehem, in Judea," they replied, "for this is what the prophet has written. But you, Bethlehem, in the land of Judah, are by no means least among the rulers of Judah. For out of you will come a ruler who will shepherd my people Israel." Then Herod called the Magi secretly and found out from them the exact time the star had appeared. He sent them to Bethlehem and said, "Go and search carefully for the child. As soon as you find him, report to me so that I too may go and worship him." After they had heard the king, they went on their way, and the star had been seen when it rose went ahead of them until it stopped over the place where the child was. When they saw the star, they were overjoyed. On coming to the house, they saw the child with his mother Mary, and they bowed down and worshipped him. Then they opened their treasures and presented him with gifts of gold, frankincense, and myrrh. And having been warned in a dream not to go back to Herod, they returned to their country by another route. This is the word of the Lord. Thanks be to God.
Well, good evening. The opening line that I wrote for my sermon this evening was, "It's so good to be welcoming you all back into Keele Chapel in person," which is lovely for those who are here, but a little sadder for the many and majority who are joining us via the live stream. But we're together in spirit, and it's good that we have the technology that allows us to do that. I don't know about you, but up until a couple of years ago, I'd always assumed that getting to see history in the making would be pretty cool. These days, I feel I've had rather enough of history. I imagine that most of us feel we've discovered our limits and gone beyond them in ways we couldn't have imagined since the last time we were singing carols in this chapel. In the midst of so many new experiences, it's good to return to these familiar readings that we're hearing this evening. And the familiar words from John's Gospel that will close our service shortly: "The Word became flesh and lived among us." Or, as a more contemporary translation puts it, "The Word became flesh and blood and moved into the neighborhood." God, who has always been closer than breathing, comes closer still, and pitches a tent in the middle of the mess. God has never just sat back and watched us struggle. God comes to us as we are, takes our hand, and walks with us through every uncertainty the future might hold, the good and the bad, the earth shaking and the mundane. And that passage goes on, "The light shines in the darkness, and the darkness did not overcome it." Sometimes in Christian circles, it's popular to say that light banishes darkness, that darkness and light cannot coexist. But of course they can and do. A single candle in a darkened church doesn't illuminate the whole building, but sometimes it's enough. And I don't know about you, but I need to be reminded of that right now. There's an understandable drive to feel that we need the light back. We need things to go back to normal. Or maybe even that this Christmas needs to be the most Christmassy Christmas ever to somehow make up for everything we've been through. But if you're anything like me, that's not where you're at. This pandemic has been and remains a traumatizing event. And our bodies respond to trauma in ways that are completely outside our conscious control. A traumatizing event overwhelms our normal capacity to cope. It breaks connections from our sense of self and safety and from others. It shatters our assumptions about the way the world should work and it leaves us feeling powerless. There's that loss of control, the uncertainty, the not knowing. And as a traumatizing event, a pandemic is different from something like an earthquake or a flood. It's slower and longer and more complex. We're living through a prolonged situation of uncertainty and anxiety, and that's exhausting and overwhelming. And despite so many strides forward, there are so many ways in which it continues to be ongoing. And it doesn't make any difference whether you've had a relatively good or bad journey over the last couple of years. Just because others have survived worse doesn't invalidate what you've experienced. So if you're continuing to struggle with what's going on, and I think we all are, please be kind to yourself. That's completely normal. Maybe when we acknowledge and accept the darkness, the light, however small and flickering and vulnerable, seems all the more miraculous. Last Christmas, a fellow priest named Lizzie Green posted on Twitter, "When we know that life sucks, the wonder that God would choose to be born among it all and to dwell amongst us is almost overwhelming. When we feel alone, being able to call God Emmanuel, God with us, is even more astonishing." And that's what we celebrate at Christmas, that Jesus came to be Emmanuel, God with us. As Archbishop Michael Ramsay once said, God is Christ-like, and in God there is no un-Christ-likeness at all. So when we look at Jesus, we see exactly what God is like. When we read the accounts of Jesus' life in the Bible, we see this amazing human being, passionate and colourful, exciting, earthy and funny. The one who was born under the most extraordinary and humble and bizarre of circumstances. The one who made homebrew in 30-gallon jars. The one who made a whip to drive traders out of the temple. The one who wept for the death of a friend and the plight of Jerusalem. The one who told startling stories and used vivid images to get his point across about tiny seeds and huge camels and people with planks in their eyes. When we look at Jesus, we see what God is like. Jesus is God with us, Emmanuel. That's the God we draw close to this Christmas. Or perhaps more importantly, the God who draws close to us. A God who knows and understands what we're feeling tonight. The good and the bad, the earth shaking and the mundane, the huge losses and the tiny ones. It's not always okay, but we're not alone. Over the last couple of years, it's often felt as if everyone needs more than anyone can give. And when we feel like that, the light of the world, that inextinguishable flicker of brightness, continues to draw us on through the surrounding darkness and illumine for us the God who has ever been by our side. So I close with a blessing for troubled times by a fellow chaplain from Atlanta called Laura Jean Truman. Blessed are the angry. Blessed are the brokenhearted. Blessed are the overwhelmed and the scared and the ones who want to give up. May you know that you're not alone, that you're braver than you think, that you are enough for even this moment, that you are beloved. Amen.
at a time of festivities and in this season of peace and joy. Let us pray. Let us pause to remember those for whom this is not a silent or a peaceful night. For those like Mary, experiencing the struggles of labour and childbirth. We pray especially for young mothers and those without the security and support of a loving family. We pray for nurses, midwives, and doctors, those trained here and elsewhere, who work in challenging circumstances made yet worse by the pandemic. We remember those like the shepherds, making a living from the land, those experiencing the daily struggle to make enough and having to deal with the changing climate and a diminished workforce. Recalling the landlord of Bethlehem, let us pray for the hospitality industry. Those who, rather than experiencing the boom of a census filling all their rooms or of Christmas parties back to back, are experiencing cancellations and new regulations, struggling to pay their bills or find staff to work. Let us remember too those for whom there is no room this Christmas. Those who struggle to find a place of safety to call home, and those for whom travelling home is a journey towards danger or fear. Let us remember places like Bethlehem, then as now a troubled place, for the land that we often call holy, but where barriers divide and freedoms are restricted. For countries and communities ripped open by poverty, conflict, and war, we pray. Let us remember those like Herod, who have power over others. We pray especially for those who, like Herod, abuse or become corrupted by the power they have. We pray for our leaders in government, business, and commerce, those who make decisions that affect the many, and especially that affect those in most need. Like Mary, Joseph, and Jesus, who had to flee to Egypt for safety, let us pray for those facing persecution, those fleeing from poverty and injustice, those who are prepared to risk crossing a channel on a dinghy for the chances of a better life, or those whose welcome consists of substandard housing or unwelcoming neighbours. Like the Magi, let us remember those who look forward to the future with hope and optimism. Let us pray for those who plan, research, and teach, for those that seek to make the world a better place. Remembering Jesus entered into the world in a specific place at a specific time. We remember the world we live in today. We pray especially for the ongoing pandemic and the work to combat COVID. We pray for those who are now seen as key workers, for the many on the front line as well as those locked in their homes, or fearful of the future, Let us pray for all those who are on our own hearts and minds at this time. We remember that you came as Emmanuel, God with us. So we ask you to draw near afresh. Come close and be at work in us and in this your world. For these prayers we ask in the name of Jesus, the one we call the Prince of Peace. Amen.
Reading from the Gospel of John, chapter 1. In the beginning was the Word, and the Word was with God, and the Word was God. He was with God in the beginning. Through him all things were made. Without him nothing was made that has been made. In him was life, and that life was the light of all humankind. The light shines in the darkness, and the darkness has not overcome it. There was a man sent from God whose name was John. He came as a witness to testify concerning that light, so that through him all might believe. He himself was not the light. He came only as a witness to the light. The true light that gives light to everyone was coming into the world. He was in the world. And though the world was made through him, the world did not recognize him. He came to that which was his own, but his own did not receive him. Yet to all who did receive him, to those who believed in his name, he gave the right to become children of God. Children born not of natural descent, nor of human decision, or a husband's will, but born of God. The Word became flesh and made his dwelling among us. We have seen his glory, the glory of the one and only Son who came from the Father, full of grace and truth. This is the word of the Lord.
Thank you.
big thank you to everyone that has been involved tonight, to our musicians, our choirs, our organist, to our readers, especially this year to AVS, and to everyone who has made this evening possible. So if you will join me in showing the traditional sign of appreciation to all those people. Those of you who are in the chapel, it is customary at this time of the year that the chapel makes a contribution to our local food bank. If you are able to make a financial donation, there are collection boxes on the way out. If you're able to join us for some festive refreshment, then we'd very much welcome you to do so. This year, that's being served in the KPA clubhouse. If you're not sure where that is, then just follow me down at the end. If you're around over the Christmas period, then we'd very much like to welcome you to any of our services that take place in the chapel, either in person or online via our live stream, and full details of those services will be found on the chapel Facebook page. So thank you for joining us. On behalf of the chaplaincy team, I'd like to wish you all the peace and joy of Christmas. And so a final blessing. May the joy of this season fill us. May the peace of this season dwell within us. May the hope of this season uphold us. May the mystery of God in human form lead us in wonder. And may the love which flows from God, Creator, Redeemer, and Sustainer, be with us this Christmas time and forevermore. Amen.